you try your best, but you don't succeed. When you get what you want, but not what you need. When you feel so tired, but you can't sleep. Stuck in tears come streaming down your face. When you lose something you can't replace. When you love someone but it goes to waste. Could it be down below. When you're too in love to let it go. But if you never try, you'll never know just what you're. Stream down your face when you lose something that you cannot replace. Tears stream down your face and tears stream down your face. And I promise you I will learn from my mistakes. Tears stream down your face and
fix you. Good evening, Envision Community Church. My name is Heather Lynn. Pronouns are she, they. And I'm grateful that you are here tonight. Thank you for being here. That was the first of basically two gathering songs, which we've been doing since 2020 when we started live streaming and got to enfold into our community, our global branch. So they are here with us now in the house. So let's give them a little shout out, a little love. Global Branch, say hello in the chat if you are able to do so. We'd love to know that you're here. We love to welcome you, and you're also welcome to share the live stream. Everyone here in the chapel, we want you to know that you can make yourself at home. So all of the invitations are invitational. So during this next song, if you want to, if you need to get up and help yourself to a hot cup of coffee or tea in the back corner, please feel free to do so, all right? And also, if you are here for the very first time, thank you for arriving here and coming out to meet us and be in this space with us. We have newcomer cards on clipboards around the space, so if you'd like to share your thoughts, your info, and then place that in the offering bag later on in our time together, we would love to hear from you. Some of these songs might be new to some of us. They might be old, but we haven't necessarily sung them together in a while. But they have some repeats. So please feel free to make a joyful noise, truly. Just sing out as much as you like, or just take it in. And when the songs catch you, feel free to clap along, dance along, sing along. All right, sound good? All right, I love it, I love it. Let's give in to the love that is all around us, covering the universe, the love that's deep within us, infusing all upon the earth. Give in to the love, give in to the love that's all around you. Covering the universe, give in to the love, give in to the love that's deep within you, infusing all upon the earth. Rising, we are rising with the light divine, radiating in our hearts on the path from obscurity into clarity. Oh, give in to the love, give in to the love that's all around you. Covering the universe, give in to the love, give in to the love that's deep within you, infusing all upon the earth. Blessed, we are blessing on the way of love, holding out the sacred flame, free of shame, with a welcome, not a weapon. Oh, give in to the love, give in to the love that's all around you. Covering the universe, give in to the love, give in to the love that's deep within you, infusing all upon the earth. Blessed, blessed, we are blessing on the way of love, holding out the sacred flame, free of shame, with a welcome, not aware. Yeah, you got this. Oh, give in to the love, give in to the love that's all around you. Covering the universe, give in to the love, give in to the love that's deep within you, infusing all upon the earth. To live, mad to love, mad to be saved. Mad to live, mad to love, mad to be saved. Made to live, made to love, made to give in to the love. Give in to the love, give in to the love that's all around you. Covering the universe, give in. to the love that's all around you, covering the universe. Give in to the love, give in to the love that's deep within you, infusing all upon the earth. Give in to the love. Yes, amen. Amen. Yes, come on up. Let's welcome the people, Toby. Let's welcome Toby.
Hi, I'm Toby. My pronouns are they, them. And I'd like to welcome you to Envision Community Church. And we do that with our ethos. Married, divorced, and single here. It's one family that mingles here. Conservative and liberal here. We've all got to give a little here. Big and small here, there's room for us all here. Doubt and belief here, we all can receive here. LGBTQ and plus and straight here, there is no hate here. Woman, non-binary, and man here, we all can here. Whatever your race here, for all of us, grace here, in imitation of the ridiculous love the Almighty God has for each of us and all of us, let us live in love without labels.
Amen, amen. Thank you, Toby. Appreciate you so much. Let's stand together as each is able and willing. And remembering that standing together is a sign of presence together, attention together. And so if you're tired and you're like, man, I'm going to feel more present, taking a different posture, I don't know, feel free to stretch out on the couch if you want to. All right? And then, like I said, add your voice, your breath, your energy as these songs catch you. And as you desire to, celebrating the gift of this church, of community, of being here together in Christ's love, in divine love. So give me your hand, friends, and we'll walk down together. Lift up your hands if you want to, and we'll sing here together. Lift up your hands and we'll sing here together. How good it is to know you, God. How lovely is your bride. How blessed we are to have each other. Dancing, Tanya. Yeah. Lift up your hearts and we'll dream here together. How good it is to know you, God. How lovely is your bride. How blessed we are to have each other.
Too poor, too dirty, too
mind. How blessed we are to have each other. You hold us all close by your side. Give me your hand and we'll walk down together. Lift up your hands and we'll sing here together. Amen. Let's pray together if you're willing. God, we just give you thanks. Thank you for one another. Thank you for bringing us together in your name. Thank you for bringing us together in the desire to both receive and to give limitless love, expansive love, to live and love together without labels. And we welcome you to allow your spirit to teach us and guide us to grow in this, to deepen our roots in this love. And thank you for the reminder, too, that Jesus, you said that we are the light of the world. And so we pray that you would empower us and enable us to shine, perhaps in ways that we haven't thought of before. It's said that you can do far more than we can ask or imagine. So in this space of gratitude for one another, we just open our hearts to you and what you're up to and what you want to get done in us and through us. This song is really new to us, but it's really simple. And so we'll just repeat. I'll sing you the first part, and then we'll sing it together. And I go from there. Together, so glad. So glad I found you. God is around you, and all that's about you shines with. Next part is different words, same sounds. Your harmonies if you want to. Love won't deny you. Love won't confine you. Free words inside you. Top. So glad I found. Simple reminders that are so significant. May these bring you peace. Beloved children of God, peace to your hearts, minds, souls, and spirits. Let's share a sign of Christ's peace tonight, greeting one another in the name of love. Global Branch, thank you again for your presence here. Hope you are well today. Whatever state of being you're in, glad that you're here. And if you haven't said hello in the chat yet, please do so. Let us know you're here that way, and maybe share where on the globe you are. If you haven't shared the live stream yet, this is a great time to do that, maybe with a word of why it matters to you to extend the invitation. And momentarily, Paula will be here kicking off a series on Romans.
It's so good to see all of you on a holiday weekend. Nice and warm. Tomorrow's going to be a little bit cooler. I pay for this weather app that, like, monthly, that gives me, like, nerd qualities. So I can tell you exactly, well, it's a bit of a sad thing, really. But tomorrow will be nice, a little cooler. Then it actually won't hit 90 for the remainder of the week, just in case you're concerned. It will be in the mid to upper 80s. For the rest of the week. Not much chance of rain most afternoons. So, we're going to be studying a book that I have wanted to study for a long time. The book of Romans. We've not done it here since the church began, which is almost 6 years. And it is, in fact, the one letter to the first century church that explains Christianity better than any other. It's Paul's, the Apostle Paul's, most important work. He wrote 14 of the 27 books of the New Testament, but Romans was by far his most significant. That's because most of those books were written to churches that were having all kinds of trouble. People couldn't get along. They were doing things terribly wrong. This book was written to a church that was getting along just fine. So it was his treatise on what Christianity is all about. But before we can begin studying the book of Romans, we got to have a few disclaimers. And so this evening is all disclaimer. So the first disclaimer is the reality that Christianity is, in fact, and has always been a patriarchal religion. And this is an issue. Why? Because there are more Christians in the world than there are anything else. 2.1 billion people in the world identify as Christian. 37% of them are in North and South America, 26% in Africa, 24% in Europe, and 13% in Asia. So almost half, 37%, are from North and South America. So that's one aspect of Christianity. The other is that about 50% of the Christians in the world are Roman Catholic. That's been pretty consistent for quite some time now. 49% of the Christians in the world are Protestant. About 1% are Orthodox. So the Catholic Church has never allowed women in the priesthood. If you've gone to a Catholic church that has women priests, it's not a Roman Catholic church. It would be the American Catholic Church, which is a very, very small denomination. So even the very progressive pope we have now is not about to allow women to be priests, because that's a change the church is simply not going to allow at this point. So 50% of the Christian population don't believe women should be in charge. So it gets worse. Let's take the 1% who are Greek Orthodox. Yeah, not them either. Okay, now 51% don't think women should ever be in charge in any kind of a spiritual environment. So let's look at Protestantism. And in Protestantism, 55% of Protestants in the world are evangelical, which means 55% of them do not believe women should be in leadership. So that's about 75% of the church. So it's really clear to you, probably obvious by now, that we are a part of the other 25%, since we have two co-pastors, both who aren't just women, but also happen to be gay. So that makes us a good bit different. The church from which we rent also has a perspective that allows women into leadership. But let's be clear, that's 25% of the Christian population. Now, that's way better than it was 100 years ago, but still, it's 25%. It's a patriarchal religion. And now, kind of moving on from that, Jesus didn't help with that in one way. The understanding of the Hebrew people was that the Messiah would be a rabbi. To be a rabbi, you had to have 12 men following you. And so when Jesus chose 12 disciples, he chose 12 men. Now, the other part of that is, did he teach that men were in charge? No. No place in the Gospels does Jesus say that men should have power over women. Not once, not ever, nothing. Just like Jesus said nothing about being LGBTQ. Jesus never said anything about sexual identity. When it comes to gender identity and gender equality, he was the very first one of any of the major religions to teach gender equality. So what happened? Yeah, four patriarchal men wrote the book about him. So we know, for instance, that the first apostle was Mary Magdalene, bankrolled his entire ministry. Clearly the most important apostle, the first one there after the resurrection. And yet the four men, do they mention her as an apostle? No, not, nope, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John only talk about the 12. And so we don't realize that Jesus, in fact, was not endorsing the concept that only men could leave the church. It was those writing about him that chose to leave out a good bit of what he said. But who's done the most damage to the church and to women in Western civilization when it comes to spirituality? Oh, by far, the Apostle Paul. And the Apostle Paul in just two of his letters. One letter to the church in Corinth, which was a mess, and truth be told, everybody there just needed to shut up and listen. But he only told the women to. Really, Paul? Really? Then, in 1 Timothy 2, there are no issues with people who should keep quiet there, and yet he tells Timothy, his protege, that in fact, no woman should ever teach a man. Any place, any time, including in spiritual settings. So Paul, like most humans that I've met, was also extremely complicated. So when we take a look at the New Testament books, there's only one writer who says all people are equal under Jesus. Who was that? Paul. So one side of his mouth, he's saying women can't be in charge, and with the other side of his mouth, he's saying Jew, Greek, male, female, old, young, pretty much he's saying our ethos, which, by the way, the only person who's ever said that memorized except for me is Toby. I just want to point that out. So here we have a great, great conflict in Paul himself. And of course, that's just the reality of the implicit bias we all hold when we grow up in a particular culture. And that was an extremely patriarchal culture. So let's take a look a little bit at what Paul was like. So Paul was born in Tarsus. Tarsus was the Chicago of the day. Major university was there, a major trading center. It was, in fact, where they traded animals. So, you know, think the Chicago stockyards. This was Tarsus. And he grew up in a middle-class part of town. He was a Cubs fan, I'm pretty sure. Came from the north side of Chicago. And then he went off to an Ivy League university back east. Now, it wasn't Harvard or Yale. It was more than likely maybe Dartmouth or Brown. You know, it was not the absolute top. It was the second to the top. And he went to Jerusalem and studied under Gamaliel. And there, in this most liberal of environments, he became a rabid right-wing believer. Wanted to kill all Jews who had become Christians. We've never seen that before, have we? People go to a place like Harvard and Yale and then go and become a governor of a southern state where they end up becoming extremely right-wing? We've never seen that, have we? The contradictions we have as humans are great. So Paul gets this very liberal Jewish teaching from Gamaliel and then proceeds to be the most adamant in persecution of Jews who had become Christians, to the point of wanting them killed. So he either said it was okay and approved of and thought it was a good thing that Stephen became the first martyr in the New Testament, or he might have actually been the one who approved to the rest, saying, can we kill this guy? And he's like, absolutely, you can kill this guy. That's Paul. We also know, by the way, a lot of people thought it was important to tell us he was about 4'6", with a crook in his nose and a bald head. So basically, he was a short version of Mr. Burns. So, you know, this was not a particularly handsome man, but he was a very powerful man and a powerful thinker. And he impacts the world with Christianity more than anyone else. What happens? He's on his way to Damascus. He's going to persecute Christians there. He's blinded by a white light. He hears Jesus say to him, why are you persecuting me? He's blind for 3 days. He's led into Damascus. He goes and sees Ananias, who asks him what's up, and he tells him he now believes Jesus is the Messiah. Ananias baptizes him. He goes to the desert for 3 years, studies for 10 more, then goes to Jerusalem, presents himself to the disciples saying, I'm one of you. I'm an apostle. There's like 12 of us, and one like killed himself. And so there was like 11, and then we kind of did a stupid thing. We just cast lots to pick a 12th. So what makes you think you're an apostle? You were never there? And he said, oh, when I was in the desert, Jesus came in bodily form and taught me. And if you grew up evangelical, this is what you're taught. Okay, so they believe him, and now he is seen as one of the apostles, and he's the one who takes the gospel all over the world on 3 missionary journeys. What kind of personality did he have? He was very strong-willed. Now, if you were at our retreat a couple of winters ago, you know that we did the DISC test, and then we've talked a good bit about the Enneagram. We'll have to do that again sometime. We'll have Mara and Christy come and do a whole thing with the DISC and the Enneagram for us. So on the DISC, he was a dominant conscientious, which means his dyad was he was very dominant in all settings, plus he was very, very focused on the details. Today, by the way, the kind of person who tends to be a Fortune 500 CEO. That was his personality on the DISC. On the Enneagram, oh, he was an 8. Through and through, a pure 8, who if there's anything he knew, it was everything. And he never had any doubts about any of it. If he knew it, it was certain, it was sure, that was that. And it plays out significantly. So on his first trip, missionary trip, he goes along with Barnabas. Why Barnabas? Because nobody else can get along with him. Barnabas can get along with him. Why? Because Barnabas is an Enneagram 2. For those of you who don't know the Enneagram, that's someone who is very much wanting to empower others. How do we know? He was an Enneagram 2. He took it on a Thursday. It was October, I think. We know he was Enneagram 2 because his name was Joseph. His nickname was Barnabas, and Barnabas translated meant one who encourages others. So his very nickname was Encourager. So basically, he's Christy Vernon. You know, he is, in fact, the guy who welcomes everybody and loves everybody. I mean, you're a 2, right? You're a 2. Yes, you are a 2. So, yeah, so he's an S on the DISC, and he's willing to put up with Paul because 2s tend to be able to put up with 8s. And so they go on this missionary journey, and they take a young Mark with them. Mark is pretty immature. For whatever reason, Paul doesn't think a good one. He goes back home in the middle of the trip. And so Paul has a long memory. Barnabas, being a 2, has a short memory, is more than willing to forgive, comes time for the next missionary journey, and Barnabas says, I will go get Mark. And Paul says, oh, no, you won't. Not after he went home by himself. And so Barnabas now, as a healthy 2 will do, Note that, for those of you again who know the Enneagram, as a healthy two will do, he sets a boundary. He says, in that case, I'm not going with you. I'm going with Mark because I am committed to mentoring this kid. And what he did was okay. And Paul angrily then goes by himself on the missionary journey. Strong-willed man. So later on, he and Peter get into it. Now, Peter's arguably the most important of the 12 disciples. And so everybody's known this was going to come. And it comes on an interesting subject because Peter kind of believes that everybody who becomes a Christian should follow Jewish laws too, 613 of them. Paul says strongly, no, no, and no. Which is actually pretty significant because Paul, even more than Peter, was one who believed in the importance of following those laws. So it shows he had in fact changed 180 degrees. He's saying to Peter and everyone else, you cannot force people to follow Jewish customs when they become Christians. And he's particularly saying this to the church in Galatia because all of northern Galatia, nobody was a Jew who was a Christian. They were all Celtic people. So he took a strong stand there. But I think there's one story that shows more than any other just how strong his personality was. 26th, 27th chapter of Acts, he's a prisoner going to Rome to appear before Caesar. As a Roman citizen, he has a right to appear before Caesar. So he gets down where he's supposed to board the ship, and he's a prisoner with rights. So, I mean, he's not shackled. He's on the manifest, and he shows up, and he says to the captain, the owner of the ship, yeah, actually, you really don't want to sail now. I hear you're headed to the harbor at Phoenix. Bad time of the year, terrible storms on the Adriatic Sea. You really should wait a season. And the captain and the owner of the ship are looking at each other. Who is this clown? He's not a sailor. He doesn't know anything about the ocean, the sea, and yet he's quite sure of himself. Forget it, Paul. We're setting sail. They set sail three days out. A terrible storm kicks up like a hurricane. Bible says it was a nor'easter hurricane force winds. They're starting to throw everything overboard. And after 11 days, Luke in the book of Acts tells us all 276 seasoned sailors aboard lost all hope. Now, what would Barnabas have done? Barnabas would have been going around to every single one of them saying, it's okay, it's going to be okay. Tell me about your family. Tell me what matters. This is what Barnabas would have been doing, not Paul, no. What Paul says is, I told you so. True dominant eight fashion. I told you this was going to happen, but here's the thing. Nobody's going to die. In fact, nobody's even going to get hurt. Not a single hair of anybody's head is going to be harmed. How do I know? Because an angel has spoken to me. Now, you know, you can see the 276 sailors saying, yeah, right. And the Rockies are going to win the World Series sometime soon. You know, I mean, it's after 14 days, finally, the storm's settling down. He says, let's eat. They sit down to eat. They haven't eaten in a couple of weeks. And he says, you cannot eat yet until I pray. And he prays a prayer of thanksgiving, and then they eat. This very strong-willed man, we're going to find out in the book of Romans, also becomes a very meek and importantly defeated man in ways he needed to be defeated. So the book of Romans itself, it was written to the church in Rome. Paul was intending to go to Spain to stop in Rome on the way, and he wanted them to know what he believed about Jesus. And so in the book, he basically is saying three things. In the first eight chapters, he says, I want you to know what God has done for you. And that's the whole focus of the first eight chapters, what God has done for us. Then chapters 9 through 11, he says, I'm just going to take a little detour and talk about how God plans to deal with Israel now that Israel is not a part of the church for the most part going forward. So it basically wasn't written to you and me. It was written to the people of Israel. And we'll kind of go through those three chapters pretty fast. So you kind of can jump from the end of chapter 8, which is a beautiful explosion of joy, right to the beginning of chapter 12, where he begins by saying, so, on account of the stuff I just talked to you about in the first 8 chapters, this is how I expect you to live. And so the last 4 chapters of Romans are telling us how we should live. And I'm here to tell you, most of what you've heard about that, if this doesn't all sound foreign to you, if it sounds foreign to you, that's absolutely marvelous. It means you haven't been poisoned. But if it doesn't, if it does sound foreign to you, pretty much everything Paul said has been taken out of context and misused by the conservative church and by the Catholic Church. What we're going to see is that he talks about a very generous Christianity. And next week, we'll start with the first chapter. And the first chapter is maybe the most important if you happen to be queer, because that's the chapter, the clobber passage that all of evangelicalism hits us with, that we are not supposed to be in gay relationships. And we're going to talk next week about the fact that we are, in fact, just fine being in gay relationships. So that's where they're going, where we're going over the next several weeks with a couple of breaks. In that, we'll have a break where Tanya is going to be preaching for us. Yay! And also another break when I'm out of town in October, but we'll be going straight through all of that, pretty much do 2 chapters a night. So with that, I'm going to pray. God, thank you for the scriptures, not because they're some magic book, but because they tell us a lot about those who encountered you in the flesh, which is kind of important for us to know. It's clear Paul was a man of such contradictions, but then, you know, so am I. So is pretty much everybody I know. What's obvious to me is that he allowed you into his heart. And at the end of my days, that's what I pray for. That it would be obvious to people that I've let God into my heart. Amen.
Overhead, leave it to me.
Little Eddie Vedder there. Let's worship together now with our gifts and our offerings. I was momentarily distracted there. We're good. Awesome. Let's worship with our offerings. All the ways to give are listed at our website, envisioncommunitychurch.org, where you could set up a recurring gift if you're so moved and able to participate and fuel life and ministry in that way. That would be amazing. If you'd like to text a one-time donation, you could do that now to the number 84321. Also, there's paypal.me/ECCgift. And of course, there are offering bags going around in the space here. So thank you so much for your generosity and contribution, participating in God's flow of abundance in the ways that you're moved. Thank you.
Thanks. My name is Christy. I'm a co-pastor here. My pronouns are she, her. Welcome and thanks again for spending Labor Day weekend Sunday here with us at church. As the sun sets earlier and the days become cooler and the crops near harvest, we celebrate the plentitude of fruits available to us. As we celebrate this sacrament, may we remember the laborers in the fields, the harvesters of wheat and grapes, the transporters of their yields, those who transform wheat into bread and grapes into juice. Bless their hands and feet as they labor at farms and gardens, in trucks and warehouses. We give thanks for the ones who prepare the table here today. May their gifts of preparation and hospitality inspire us to extend hospitality to the strangers among us. After laboring on the streets of Jerusalem, doing justice, loving kindness, and walking humbly with God, Jesus clutched bread in his hands. He blessed it, he broke it, and heartfully expressed to his friends that this is the bread of life. As you eat this bread, remember me. After supper, Jesus grasped the cup filled with the gifts of the vine. In his blessing, he reminded them, whenever you drink of this cup, remember me. Spirit of wisdom and wonder, wind around these elements today. May they stir us from stagnation into actively loving God, our neighbors, and ourselves. May our participation at this table transform us into the people that God is calling us to be. With gratitude, we gather at this table. As we take a piece of bread, let us experience the love of God as seen in Jesus the Christ. As we sip from the cup, let us remember the grace that pours from God. At this church, we have an open table, which means that during communion, everyone without exception is invited to take the bread or the gluten-free crackers and the grape juice, which for us represents the body and blood of Christ. If you prefer not to join us at the table, you can remain seated. We also have a bank of candles in the back of the room. Light a candle, say a prayer. Write in the prayer journal. Paula will be off to the side, available to pray with any of you about anything. And if you would just like a simple blessing, come to her with your arms crossed, and she will do that for you as well. If you're joining us virtually, please take whatever elements that you have and join us in communion. And I invite the rest of you to come as you are ready.
Heavenly Creator, you always amaze me. Let your kingdom come in my world and in my life. You give me the food I need to live through the day. And forgive me as I forgive the people that wrong me. Lead me far from temptation. Deliver me from the evil one. I look out the window. The birds are composing. dressed than any girl on her wedding day. So why do I worry? Why do I freak out? God knows what I need. You know what?
Shannon and Lonnie to come up because they are part of announcements today.
I love group announcements.
I know.
Team, go team.
Go team. We can't do all the community events without the generous contributions of community. So y'all can come up. Just come up. I'm going to do these out of date order, so it'll probably mess up the slides. But I'll go first and just say that we are having an LGBTQ plus dinner party at Paula's home on September 15th at 6:30. So please RSVP for that and also bring drinks, bring desserts to share. And you can see Paula or I for more information on that. And I'm gonna pass it to the next date that's out of order, which would be Shannon.
Hello, everyone. Yes, I am up here to invite you to the discussion next Sunday after service. We're going to watch a couple of Richard Rohr videos, Christianity and Unknowing. The inspiration for this comes from this last February. We had a discussion with Brené Brown and Richard Rohr over a podcast, and it was very lively and super interesting. And one byproduct is you get to learn a little bit about each other in these discussions beyond just the context of the videos. So you can also come and just hang out. Feel free to bring an appetizer, easy finger food, charcuterie board, you know, things like that. So come and join us. The links are on the Facebook invite. If you're not a Facebook person, they are on the website.
Should they watch the video before they come?
Oh my gosh, yes.
Thanks, Shannon.
Hey everyone, my name is Lonnie. My pronouns are she and hers. And I am a nerd. I'm a really big nerd. I love reading books. Yeah, all right, I see you out there. We'll form a club. But one of the ways that I love to just engage with people is through books. And so coming up, we're going to have a book discussion group, just meeting four times, September 19th, October 3rd, October 17th, October 31st, over the book Freeing Jesus by Diana Butler Bass. And she really does a great job of giving us open ways of thinking about Jesus based on our experiences, based on some of the things we know about history. And so the goal is, as you know, Shannon mentioned, yeah, come talk about a book, but get to know each other. I mean, one of the ways I think that we deepen our relationships is just by sharing our lives and our faith in casual settings. So put those dates on your calendar if you're interested, and don't have to read the book. If you just still come and show up, have be part of the discussion. The last meeting, October 31st, is on Halloween, so we will be having a come as your favorite Bible character night. Just kidding. No, just kidding. Yeah. So anyways, if you have questions about that, please let me know. But if you are at all interested, either show up or you're welcome to contact me. I will have some information about the chapters that we'll cover in the different four sessions coming out very soon. So, thanks, everyone.
Lonnie, is that going to be online?
Yes, and there is 1 week. Thank you, Nancy, and thank you for checking in on that. So, for the Global Branch, on October 4th, the Global... Oh, is it? Okay. Sorry, I got my dates wrong. October 25th. Is the Global Branch meeting, and that will be also an online discussion about the book as well. So Global Branch, get ready. We're going to have a great time. Thanks.
Good. Yeah, awesome. For more information about any and all events, you can check the web page, envisioncommunitychurch.org, or you can go to the Facebook events and find out more information. I just want to acknowledge that Brittany and Megan, who have been working with our children for the last, I don't know, couple of years, their life circumstances have changed with jobs and whatnot, and they aren't working with the kids anymore. And because of the timing, we have not done a proper party and send-off and appreciation for them. So that will be coming. And I want to acknowledge Jenny in the back of the room, who is filling in for an undetermined length of time, depending on her schedule, with the kids. So I'm so grateful to her for stepping in to do that. And then also for the volunteers who will be rotating weekly to work with Jenny with the kids. So if that's something that is calling to you and you would like to spend 1 week a month or 1 week a quarter hanging out with the kiddos, we would love to have you do that. You can just see me for more information. That's it. Yeah, thanks.
Beautiful, thank you. Let's stand together as each is able and willing as we go on our way. I kind of picked this song in honor of Labor Day weekend. May God indeed bless the works of your hands, my friends, and may those works be full of heart. And I think, I mean, this is just a really fun, simple song, but I think it's like literally, like we can change the world with these hands God has given us. And also, no matter how many hands you have or what the case may be, there's a metaphorical meaning, right? Like we each have a personality, we each have gifts and skills to share and to love people to life. Amen? So sing this as it so moves you.
I can change the world with my own two hands, make it a better place with my own two hands, make it a kinder place with my own. can make peace on earth with my own two hands. I can clean up the earth with my own two hands. I can reach out to you with my own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands. I'm gonna make it a brighter place with my own two hands. I'm gonna make it a safer place with my own two hands. I'm gonna help the human race with my own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands. Now I can hold you with my own two hands, and I can comfort you with my own two hands. But you got to use your own two hands, use your own, use your own two hands, use your own.
Sending blessing is from Teresa of Avila. She said, Christ has no body but yours, no hands, no feet on earth but yours. Yours are the eyes with which he looks compassion on this world. Yours are the feet with which he walks to do good. Yours are the hands with which he blesses all the world. Yours are the hands, yours are the feet, yours are the eyes. You are his body. Christ has no body now but yours. No hands, no feet on earth but yours. Yours are the eyes with which he looks compassion on this world. Christ has no body now on earth but yours. So let's go now in peace to love God, ourselves, and one another. Amen? Amen.
I can hold you with my own two hands. I can comfort you with my own two hands, but you got to use your own two hands, use your own, use your own two hands, use your own, use your own two hands, with our
Yeah.